before you get into any talk about any services with any client or a candidate or any corporate also, this is a key for you all to start with. And then you build a rapport, and then you start telling that what are the rest of the services that Rightfolio can link along with this, and you know, do the journey along with the candidate until he finishes his elections. Okay, now this is something which Rightfolio's exclusive. You search all over Google, you will not get it. In the sense, you get it, every data in bits and pieces, you get it. It's a, like a puzzle broken into small pieces. Now what we did is just brought everything together and made it in such a way that everybody understands, okay, and interpreted and you know explained, you know, with the different correlations. I'll give you an example of one particular constituency in Chhattisgarh, that is Kundagaon. Okay, there's a constituency called Kundagaon, and our product as a hard copy, of course, it looks like this. The copy, it's, can you give me the bhandi, this one? Yeah, it's here, it's here, it's here. Okay, with the cover page, okay. And it's a 45 pages or 45 to 50 pages booklet. Depends on some constituencies, it may increase, some may decrease. In the back, it's this, this. But it is looking just like a small book. But it has lot of hard work of 15 people behind this, and you know, the day and night that they worked, and also a lot of, you know, thought process gone into it, lot of interpretation gone into it, lot of guidance gone into it. Okay, a very, very you know, useful product for any aspirant of elections.
To completely understand, so that you will be able to explain it to the client, to the candidate, or to the political party. Now, this table, it contains figures. It gives you a map, and this is the population. Out of total population, you knock off almost a lakh of population who are not voters. That's the first thing that you find in this. See, 2.5 is the total population, and 1.59 or 1.6 is the voting. Okay. There's no significant difference between male voters and female voters. Just about 2,000. It's very insignificant. Which means, depending on the constituency, its past voting pattern, etc. Generally, people, you know, in the newspapers, etc., you come across these, women voted for, you know, this particular candidate or this particular party. But statistically speaking, it is not right. If you go into minute details, you know, in most of the polling booths, you have a male polling booth and a female. If you are familiar with it. Once the results are out, you just have a look at the voting behavior or the pattern. The voting preference of males and females are in no way significantly different. If in a booth of say about 1,000 voters, if 700 males have voted for a particular political party, between 680 to 720, you know, females would have voted or males would have voted. There's no, what I'm trying to tell you is that there is no clear, distinct political preference of males over females or females over males. That is something you need to understand. The numbers are also more or less the same. There could be a situation where many females might not turn up for voting because of you know, domestic responsibilities or something like that. Otherwise, statistically speaking, there is not much of a difference between the male voting preference and female voting preference. All that we hear about this talk of, oh, most of the females have voted for a particular political party, most of the males have voted for a particular political party, is statistically not valid. This is another thing. Now, this contains, apart from male-female, it contains the demographic. That's very crucial. Here it says between 18 and 29, this is the number of voters. Between 30 and 59, this is the number of voters. And that forms the largest chunk. So the candidate or the political party will have to understand the political significance of the age group of 30 to 59. That's important. So their campaign, their communication needs to be targeted to that particular segment, that because that is the largest chunk. And the chunk which is above that, that is 18 to 29. Now 18 to 29, they would contain at least about 30% first-time voters, isn't it? Because 18, they would not have voted for last election. This is the first time. 2013 in Chhattisgarh, they would not have voted. 2014 Lok Sabha in Chhattisgarh also, they would not have voted, isn't it? So this is the first time. So first-time voter is somewhere around, out of 56, it would be at least about, say, 20,000-25,000. So that is somebody who does not have a preformed opinion. Because voting, what happens is, sometimes, you know, last election also I voted for this. My family continuously voted for this particular political party. You know, last so many elections I have been voting. You know, these are certain things that would make a voter's preferences solidified. Now, this segment, which is 18 to 29, out of that, say about 20,000-25,000 voters, it's a huge chunk. So, are the fresh voters, first time voters? So, this is the significance. Of course, as I said, the 30 to 59 is the largest chunk. So the candidate will have to think about how to, so which means 87,926, that is 30 to 59%, 59 years of age group, and most of them, if you look at the 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth item, that is scheduled caste, scheduled tribe population, that is 1,73,000, which means that 14, most of them would have been scheduled tribes, isn't it? So you are looking at a voting population which is predominantly 30 to 59 and who are predominantly scheduled tribe. So what is the communication? That is how this document is helpful to the candidate. And if you look at the last, number 15, the age group which is 60 and above is only 15,000. So which means that you can, for all, I mean, I'm not talking about the moral grounds, but politically, in terms of allocating my time, allocating my resources and crafting a communication, crafting my campaign, I can, for all practical purposes, give less importance to the 15,000. I'm not suggesting that, you know, they're useless, let's not talk about them, I'm not saying that. But suppose if today I have an hour gap in my schedule, should I go and address a college or should I go and address an old age home? If I'm confronted with this kind of a choice, what do I do? What do you advise? Isn't it? If you have this table with you, you will go to a college. That is the advantage. Otherwise, what happens? A candidate, just by intuition, just by thinking, say, "Arey, buzurg log hai, let me go there and spend time." And if you go there, they'll make you sit down and talk. And they will make you spend 1 hour there. For how many votes? Maybe 10 votes, 15 votes, 30 votes. But if you go and spend that 1 hour in an engineering college, first time voters, you can impress them. So this is how this table is useful in allocating your time, in crafting your campaign communication, and also in allocating your resources. Look at the rural population and urban population. Rural population is predominant. Urban population is very small in Kondagam. So that you will understand, if you are putting out a campaign, most of your campaign material, your slogans, your issues that you take up will have to be predominantly rural oriented. That is the, say for instance, if you start addressing the municipal problems in your campaign, its appeal is very limited. What is the percentage? About 20? Can you see it properly? Number. Say about 31,000. Yeah. 31,000. But the rural population is 2,23,000 odd.
85 and 15%.
Yeah. And then you see the caste distribution. SC population, ST population and other population. So it's predominantly ST. You necessarily will have to address the rural issues, issues related to STs, and then issues related to 29 to 50, and secondly 18 to 29. You can safely ignore 60 and above. You can allocate less resources in terms of time and campaign material, etc., etc., for urban areas. So this is the overall framework of your campaign strategy for Kondagam. Then literacy. If it is predominantly illiterate constituency, then distributing pamphlets, written pamphlets, written text, door to door makes no sense. You need to choose a television, radio, and maybe voice blast on the phones, etc. If it is, say for instance, if it is Bombay North, what do? It is predominantly urban, almost 100% urban, and maybe over 70-80% literate, most of them professionals. So your campaign strategy is completely different in Bombay North from Kondagam. Okay. Here comes something that we have culled out from different sources, all authentic sources. All authentic, reliable, dependable data from Election Commission that we have culled out. And what was the polling percentage? What was the polling percentage that has increased between two elections? and how that increased polling percentage has been distributed among political parties. These are very important. In the sense, you can also find out a pattern if between last election and this election, if there was an increase of 6% in polling. When it was 80%, which party won? When it was 86%, to increase by 6% to 86%, which party had won? So increase in polling percentage favors which party? Is it that increase in the polling percentage definitely favors one particular political party, or it is taken by some other third party which has come into the picture, which wasn't there earlier? So these are the things that this page gives you. For instance, here, as per the 2018 voter list sourced from the Election Commission report, there are 159,472 voters and 229 polling stations in Kolkata. The voter turnout in 2013 assembly elections was 125,000, etc. That is 84% of votes polled in 2013. In 2008, 79.19% of votes were polled. Now, if you look at 2003, 2008 and 2013, 2003 BJP won the election, 2008 also BJP won the election, and 2013 INC had won the election. Okay. Now, let me draw your attention to another important factor here. You see, in 2003, BJP polled 42,000. In 2008, BJP polled 44,000. And in 2013, BJP polled 49,000. So actually BJP in all these three elections, it has been on the increase. The party did not lose because it has lost votes. And why I am saying this confidently is, you see, the difference between the polling percentage in 8 and 13 is about 5%. When the polling percentage has increased by 5%, which party has benefited more out of it? You see, from 41,000 in 2008, Indian National Congress has increased to 54. Whereas, BJP could increase only 5,000. So, out of the percentage that has increased between 8 and 13, larger chunk of the increased vote percentage has gone to in INC. So this time, if this document is procured by BJP, then what should BJP do? BJP should target whoever is coming into the voting list. Whatever is the increase in the voting percentage, will have to go to them rather than to the INC. And vice versa for the Congress. You know, a very significant surge in Congress voting in 2008, from 28,000 to 41,000.
13,000 every time they have increased.
Sorry?
13,000 around they have increased every time.
Such a massive increase from 2003 to 2008, but still did not make them win the election. And
from 41,000 to 54,000.
It got them through. But then 44,000 to 49,000, there's a loss. So the essential point that we have to try and make somebody who comes up with that argument is, you know, winning two elections is no guarantee for winning the third election. Now, if you, once you bring in the 2014 data, it will be much more interesting. Go to the next one.
Next slide.
Look at the 2014 election. Down below, BJP polled 50,000. Sorry? 50,300. INC 48,963. What it shows is that there is not much of a difference between the voting polled by INC in the last election and this election. Very marginal. But then there is a significant jump. Go back to the last slide. Last one, yeah. Last one, INC polled 54 and BJP polled 49. Now, next one. From 49, BJP could only go to 50. Hardly.
Same voters have voted for the both Lok Sabha and...
Exactly. Now, which means, you see, it has polled only 2,000 or slightly less than 2,000 more than INC. It has not significantly increased its vote between 2013 assembly election and 2014 Lok Sabha election. Which means, now here I'm making a very political statement. In Kondagaon, which is predominantly ST constituency, which is predominantly a rural constituency, which has a significant chunk of 18 to 29 and 30 to 59 voters, did not have Modi magic. It's important. I think what probably, you know, made BJP win a little more in 2014 compared to 2013 is the local factor, Raman Singh or something or something. Otherwise, if you go to Rajasthan, when we go to Rajasthan, you will see. If you go to Rajasthan, in most of the constituencies, between the last assembly elections and the Lok Sabha elections, there's a huge chunk of vote increase for BJP. Significant increase. Anywhere between 15,000 to 20,000 to 25,000. So there you have a very clear cut case of the national, Modi, Lok Sabha, Prime Minister candidate, etc., etc., sweeping, which did not work in Chhattisgarh. So therefore, when you go to a Chhattisgarh candidate to Kondagaon candidate, these are the significant things that he otherwise would not have. See, he would know, arre, do baar jeeta hai, tisri baar haar gaya, bas, that's all. But why? What is the increase of percentage of voting? And is it because of that increase of voting has gone to larger chunk of voting has gone to whom? These are the things that Rightfolio is going to provide. From here, you have a booth-wise voting. You see, when a candidate or a political party distributes his or her manpower, you know, all the booths which are strong over the last two elections or three elections, which are just marginal, maybe 10 to 15 votes majority, which are 10 to 15 votes minus, which are 30 to 40 votes minus, which are 100, 150 plus 100, 150 plus votes minus. This is how they have to look at it. They can look at it from these particular tables that we provide. Now, this has, next, this is the overall voters, number of voters, male, female, vote-wise. This is important, which is a value addition that Rightfolio is going to give to the candidate. These are BJP votes. BJP polled majority in these booths, majority of 1 to 15 votes in 19 booths, majority of 16 to 30 in 13 booths, etc. And these are the booths where BJP is in a minority. This, of course, this applies to the Congress. Same. So, you see, BJP has not increased their, or they have not scored a majority of 150 or more than 150 in not a single booth. Nor have they lost a booth by 150 or more than 150. But Congress has lost in one booth more than 150. Lost a booth by more than 150, the majority. And then we will also give the booth numbers later. So which means that they will have to see. Probably, you know, 1 to 15 votes difference, they can go from down below, 100 to 150, there are two votes which they have increased. 61 to 100, 13 votes, they have to concentrate there. So they can plan a strategy. They can plan their deployment of manpower and resources. Next. And location of the booth. Increase and decrease. On the far left you have the booth number. Then you have the booth location. And by how many votes they have increased. And by how many votes they have decreased. In 2014, there were 8 booths and the booth numbers that contributed to an increase of 707 votes for BJP. You see, BJP's increase between 13 and 14 was how much did we thought? About
1,000.
Just
1,000.
About 1,000 votes. Out of 1,000 votes increase between 13 and 14, 707 votes came from just 8 booths. That's the finding. That's important. Which means that if they want to retain their 2014 majority numbers, because 13 they lost. 13 they lost. They cannot compare 13. 14 had shown a bit of increase for BJP in the constituency. And that increase, out of 1,000, 700 came from these 8 booths. If BJP guards these 8 booths, then they are going to host to victory. Vice versa. If Congress has this document, they'll have to see that these 8 booths, they have to concentrate and see that BJP's majority is demolished there. That is how surgical and precise this document can help a candidate and a political party. This is the value. Not a single figure is from us. It is from Election Commission, but you need to collect them. You see, you have to collect them, categorize them, identify which are the 8 booths, and out of 1,000 votes extra that they polled between 13 and 14, 700 votes came from where?
This year.
We have done it. This is ours. No, even that is not given in Election Commission, because you see, they don't do any comparison. They will only give you 2014 BJP has polled these many votes. That's all. No, they won't. They won't even compare between 2008 and 2013 also. We need to do it. You see, when I told you that between 2008 and 2009 and 2013, 2003, 2008 and 2013, BJP's vote has been increasing, although it is lost the election. Congress also went on increasing, but 2 times they lost and 1 time they have won, 2013. Even this rising also is not given by the Election Commission. We have to make that interpretation. That is the strength. If this document is with INC, INC will have to see that these 6 votes, 17, 18, 16, 12, 168 and 170 are guarded properly. Why did we lose more than 700 votes in that 6 votes? What is the reason? Is it caste? Is it our weakness in our party? Or votes were not guarded properly? What is the reason? So if these people guard about 700, see, the difference is what? About 1,000. Out of 1,000, you are guarding 718 votes here. If you guard these 6 votes, another 300, 400 votes. So that is the advantage. That is the advantage data gives to a political party or to a candidate. See, here, in order to win an election, you are looking minutely at the booths and finally arriving at, you know, I lost by 1,000 votes. Out of these 1,000 votes, I lost 780 votes in these 8 booths, or, you know, in the 6 booths. So instead of going to a temple, you go to this 6 months. Shifted from INC to BJP in 2013 to 2014. 2013, these booths were with INC. How many? 26 booths were with INC. Those 26 booths which were in with INC in 2013 have shifted to BJP. Now, out of them, go back to the previous slide. Out of them, out of 26, 8 booths have contributed 777. That is the importance of this data. So this document can make the election data driven. You're not shooting in the dark. You're not just going and say namaste, namaste, namaste everywhere. No. You are understanding where is exactly my weak point. Precisely, you are addressing those booths. And if you go a little deeper, which of course is the local knowledge, you know, you can you can say that particular booth is mainly that particular caste lives in there, not that area. Or, you know, it's all doctors, majority of them are doctors in that area, or majority of them are advocates in that area. That's the local one. Then, which means, or it's a Muslim area, or it is a, okay. Now, that means you have lost 8 booths, almost 700 votes, which is on an average about 90 votes per booth. You see, in this constituency, you had seen, for example, that there are 220 booths or something like that initially, that's around that. And 220 out of 220 booths, BJP between 2013 and 2014, BJP could gain about 1,000 votes majority from 220 votes spread across. Now, 220, if you are not aware of the actual situation booth wise, what you will think is, what a candidate can think is, that out of 220, 1,000 votes majority I got. Normally, what is the tendency? 1,000 divided by 220.
Six
votes. But that doesn't work. That doesn't work. What works is, out of 220, 8 booths have contributed 700 votes. That is the value of this data.
Yes.
We are not only saying that 7 booths or 8 booths have contributed, we are also saying which are those booths, what are the locations. Now, we have to be a little careful because 213 and 214 are not exactly comparable. Because 213 they were voting for the state and 2014 they were voting for the national election. Still, if you look at the political party, now if 2014 is these many votes a political party has gained. Say in this case, although they lost 2013, BJP could win a majority in 2014, which means that is the potential for BJP. It cannot underperform 2013 figure, isn't it? That could be the benchmark. If BJP has got these many votes in 2014, in 2019, why should it get less than that?
That's the cutoff.
Exactly. It has to be more than that. So this is the 2000. What is the voting pattern? Each party, how many votes it polled, and what is its ranking? Is it number one or number? Number one or number two? And then what is the difference between the margins, winning margins? And then when you won or when you lost, where did you incur major losses? When you won, where did you gain majorities? How many booths have stayed with you between last election and this election? And how many booths have gone away from you, shifted from? And if they have they shifted with 1 to 10 or 11 to 30, 40, 50, 100, 150, more than 150? How many have you lost by these margins? How many have you gained by these margins? In order to make a difference between winning and losing, which are the boosts that have contributed to your loss? Which are the boosts that you need to guard? Which are the boosts that you need to concentrate on? That is the uniqueness of this document. You can simply sit and say, look, these 7 booths, I'm deploying 1,000 people there. That's it. And the rest of the thing, you know, one can go around. But if you have 1,000 workers, and 1,000 workers are evenly spread among 220 booths, then it is an onslaught. If 8 booths you deploy 500, and the rest 500 are deployed in 212 booths, all right, you won't lose. This is one of the options I'm saying. The point that I'm trying to emphasize is that you will be empowered with this knowledge to put the resources where they are needed, to understand what is the area that is eating into your winning prospects. What are the booths that are undermining you? What are the booths that are giving an advantage to your opponent? Where do you cut down the opposition to size? Because in the initial slides you have seen, just by increasing your number of votes from election to election does not ensure victory. Because if you see, BJP has been increasing its victory, I mean margin, from 8 to 13 to 3, 8 and 13. The graph is not falling, the graph is rising. But it did not ensure victory. It also gives what is the increase in percentage of voting from one election to the other. Once you know that, how many votes have increased, out of the increased votes, how many he got and how many I got.
That was the biggest difference.
And which votes? Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Now, yesterday I talked about the way Rightfolio conducts its opinion polling. What we call is survey of voters' intention. The reason why we call this survey of voters' intention is that when we ask somebody, whom do you intend voting? It's their intention that they tell us. The reason why I emphasize on intention is, we do not know, after he tells us something, after we record his opinion, his intention, he or she might change their mind, you know, after that, before the polling, or even after going into the polling station. It's possible. But by and large, the opinion that is expressed to an independent agency like ours normally is honest. And when we capture that, we take a lot of precaution to see that the constituency's profile is very precisely and faithfully reflected in the sample. For people who are not very familiar with surveys and methodologies of surveys, there is a difference between census and a survey. Census is 100%. I take a census of this room, means that everybody present in this room is talked to and some information or opinion is recorded. When we are talking about survey, we don't touch 100%, that is called the universe. 100% is not surveyed. What we do is, we do a sample of it. Now, it is the technique and methodology of sampling that is the heart of a survey. Whom do you, because in a constituency there are about 2.5 lakh voters in an assembly constituency. It is impossible to ask everybody. It is not necessary also. There are certain methodologies and there are certain techniques. If you use them scientifically, rigorously, and apply those techniques, then even 1,000 sample can yield very accurate result. For Nandyal, we had a by-election last year, caused by the death of the sitting legislator. So we did a survey. We did it twice. Once in July, next in August. And then the poll results. I'll go through quickly both the survey. It's not for just knowledge sake. It is for basing your action. Every information is actionable information. It is not information for knowledge sake. It is not that, you know, as a newspaper reader, I'm trying to know who is likely to win. That's only a piece of information. But the reader is different from a leader. Leader would like to know which segment is thinking about what, about me. If I am winning, why am I winning? If I am winning, with what kind of a margin I am winning? If I am losing, why am I losing? Which are the segments? So yesterday, I had given you, in Kondagaon and the Rajasthan constituency, I had given you an idea of, you know, which are the booths. Which are the booths which are shifting? Which are the booths which are coming to you? And which are the booths which are shifting, say, 10 and more, 20 and more, 40 and more, 100 and more, 150 and more, isn't it? So that is the gross. But when you go into this kind of a survey, I want you to impress upon the candidates and the market, is look, that is the one which gives you an overall idea. But if you engage Rightfolio to get a survey of your constituency done, then you will know at the moment what is the voter's intention, gender-wise, region-wise, caste-wise, male, female, and profession, education, income, and everything. So you can pinpoint. And then whom did they vote last time, and what is their intention for this election? What is the perception versus what is the intention? So this kind of a thing. And not just once. As you can see, we have done it in July and we have done it in August. Now, once you do it and start acting upon it, you will have to do another survey in order to understand whether we have really achieved any progress or not. If we achieved progress, where did we achieve progress? How much did we achieve progress? You see, in this, between July and August, TDP has closed the gap and over and above that gained in Gospadu Mandal, where they were actually behind YSRCP. And in Nandyal municipality and Nandyal Mandal, they found in July itself they were ahead, but they did not rest there. They increased their lead. You see, for instance, this is the Rightfolio's forecast of Nandyal result. 59.10% of vote for TDP and 39.80% of vote for YSRCP. That was the August forecast of Rightfolio. What is the actual result? 57.34% for TDP and 41.12% for YSRCP. That close we are. Yesterday, if you remember, I said we are 100% accurate in the outcome and 98% accurate in forecasting the majority margin. I want you to first of all understand what is the rate of accuracy of this study. You know, it's almost like in our second survey, from first survey to second survey, we have completely, as though we are looking at the ballot paper. It's not anymore a survey. Almost closer to the ballot. As though we were sitting, you know, in the time machine, we went ahead and looked at the counting and then we did the thing. You know, this is possible. It is possible. If you do master the technique of sampling, one. Second, it is possible to achieve this kind of a forecast result if the sample that you decide is faithfully carried out in the field. Yesterday, Sawant was saying, people are sitting in a restaurant and having tea and filling up things. If you do that, then you're gone. Even if you have Einstein sitting and giving you a sample, it won't work. And we can achieve that, a faithful carrying out of the sample, if there is proper supervision. Continuously, our supervisors will have to go around and see if these boys and girls are really going to the places where we specify, meeting the people we have specified, and noting down exactly. Say, for instance, I'll tell you what. Question number one, question number two, three, four, five, seven, eight. For some reason, and we have boxes A, B, C, you know, answer, A, B, C, answer, and we have a box. We have to note down A or B, whatever is the answer. Instead of noting down A, answer A, for question one, in the box opposite question number two, you're gone, isn't it? The entire sheet is a waste. But you don't realize that. Which means that in the field itself, they will have to be absolutely cautious. That brings us to who are the people who are going to go and get the responses. They should be experienced. They should be working with us for quite some time, know our way of doing things, how strict we are. Not anybody can do. So we have that kind of a manpower throughout the country who have been doing these kind of things in various parts of the country for a number of years. It's not possible to have just tomorrow. I mean, I want somebody in say Kashmir and, you know, I go there. It's not possible. We've been doing for a long time, long years. Therefore, they know. We normally, a lot of agencies, they go to a candidate, sir, I'll do it for 10 rupees. Why are you unnecessarily spending so much of money on those organizations? I'll give you. Well, and they pay very less per sheet. So in order for an investigator to earn, say, about 100 rupees at the end of the day, they'll have to do 100. They can't do 100. It's not practically possible. So what they do? They come and they sit somewhere and fill it up so that they earn some money at the end of the day. Whereas with us, because we pay more, they don't have to cheat this way. They can comfortably go and do 30, 40, still they get 100 rupees. That is the reason. One, they've been with us for a long time, they're trained, they know. And they also know, see, even people call us and say, look, sir, working and seeing the result from your organization, it's so fulfilling for us, because we see in the newspaper, we see in, the finding, and whatever we had done is accurately reflecting in the election. And somebody does, it's sometimes it's fluke, like for instance, a clock which has stopped working, it shows right time twice a day, isn't it? Suppose if the clock stopped at 2 o'clock, it shows right time at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and 2 o'clock in the morning. That's how surveys can be sometimes right for fluke reasons, for no reason at all. That's a different thing. But then they have a lot of full sense of fulfillment, satisfaction. When they find a survey is carried out properly, there is a methodology, there is proper supervision, and above all, there is a respectable remuneration for the labor that they have put in. That is why the surveys and the findings of Rightfolio are so accurate. That's the reason. Sampling is good, the way it's carried out is good, supervision is good, data entry is good, checking and rechecking is done. Before the data entry is done, all the data that comes is carefully examined and weeded out. Anything which is suspicious is taken out. That is the reason why we're able to achieve this kind of an accuracy.